ಯುಪಿಎ ಸರ್ಕಾರದಲ್ಲಿ
ರಾಮ ಮಂದಿರ ನಿರ್ಮಾಣದ ಮುಂದಿನ ನಡೆಯ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಮಾತಾಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಸುಬ್ರಹ್ಮಣ್ಯನ್ ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ಅವರನ್ನ ನಾನು ಅತ್ಯಂತ ಆಗ್ರಹಿಸಿದ
Our temple is something special. It is built on the basis of Akama Shastras. It is built after Prana Pratishtha Puja, where the Akama Shastris fast for 41 days. And then they do this puja, by which Lord Rama or whoever is the Lord of that, temple we are building, that God enters the murti and becomes the owner of the temple. We, in our religion, cannot have an owner of a temple. We cannot have trustees, but owner is God. And if it is so that a temple is built by the true Prana Pratishtha Puja, then it is always a temple. Whether it is in disuse, whether it is demolished, whatever, that particular statue should be taken back. So, I first tried to speak to the British government, they were not ready to listen. Naturally, they have been looting India for such a long time, they are not going to change their mind. So I went, I asked our people to file a case in the British courts and say that this is our temple property and Nataraja owns that temple. You cannot take away that statue, it has to go back to that temple. This
there was a lot of lightning and rain and so on.
In the morning, a police constable posted outside the Babri Masjid found that inside, in 1986, Rajiv Gandhi instructed the Chief Minister of UP, Veer Bahadur Singh, that then every year in Faizabad court there will be a petition, please open the lock. And the magistrate, the sessions judge, would ask the SP, if I order the opening of the lock, what will happen? And he said, no, there will be bloodshed, there will be riots, there will be this and that. So he knew this is the situation. Now I will not talk, still not go. But in 1986, February 12th, because of Rajiv Gandhi's instruction, the superintendent of police said, nothing will happen. We are capable of managing the government. So the magistrate said, the sessions judge said, open the locks. And the locks were opened, and people went inside and started doing prayers in Babri Masjid. Now, why Rajiv Gandhi did it, I do not know. I know he is a good friend of mine. He said, no, no, India, we must now come to recognize the reality. Like nowadays, Rahul Gandhi is saying, Juba Bhakta. I don't know. I asked him, why can't you say I am a Hindu instead of a Juba Bhakta? But Rajiv Gandhi then showed the serial of Ramayana of Durdarshan. Everybody in his party objected. But he said, no, I will show it. I do not know whether it was some guilt feeling, he never told me. But he was determined to allow the Ramayana to be built. So after that, of course, the Vishnu Parishad had launched its agitation. And in 1991, Chandrasekhar, as the Prime Minister, he asked me, can he find a solution? So the Babri Masjid Action Committee was Sayyid Shahabuddin. He was also a Janata Party MP. So I met him and I spoke to him. Please tell me, is there a way out? He said, there is only one way out. If you can show that there was a temple with proof, then it would be illegal to build a masjid there. And therefore, I myself will demolish the masjid. So it was put in a white paper, which is available to you today, that an agreement was reached between me and Shahabuddin, that if this can be proved that there was a masjid, then the Muslim Babri Masjid Action Committee will give up the claim to Babri Masjid. And I have also said, I was a law minister at that time, so I said I will bring this as a bill in parliament, but we also allow me to build the masjid somewhere else. Because in Ayodhya, there is no point in building a masjid. There are no Muslims there. In fact, we have 21 masjids in Ayodhya. And if you go and visit them, you will find cows, goats, buffaloes. There is nobody to go to the namaz, or to the masjid for namaz. So therefore, it was agreed somewhere far away, like Dr. Ambedkar Nagar district. In next to Ayodhya or in Lucknow or someplace like that. But unfortunately, our government failed and Chandrasekhar's government died, and elections came and the Congress Party came to power, Narasimha Rao came to power. Narasimha Rao also, heart of heart, wanted Ram to be built. But he said, I'm in Congress and I've got the lady watching me. So, let's go slowly. But the Mysuru Parishad after taking out all the murtis from the masjid, and then after the masjid was demolished, they built a small hut like temple in which they put the murtis back. Today that temple still exists. But the Supreme Court decided to hear this matter in 1993 and decided to sue because Nasim Rao gave a reference to the President of India under Article 143, who then told the Supreme Court Chief Justice, please advise me what should be done. So Supreme Court held a hearing and five judges sat there. And they came to a number of conclusions. One important conclusion is, they said that a masjid or a mosque is not an essential part of Islamic religion. In other words, the masjid has no religious significance. And this is the position in Arabia, Saudi Arabia. I got a letter from Saudi Arabia. Said masjids can be demolished. For what purpose? To build a road, build an apartment building. In fact, the masjid which was built on the direction of Prophet Muhammad in Makkah was also demolished by Saudi Arabian government to build a toilet for the pilgrims and the Hajj of Israel in town. And UNESCO protested. Said, how can you do this? So the Saudi Arabian government told UNESCO, you are not teaching us murti, that is idol worship. Murti puja, you are teaching us. Muhammad ordered this masjid today, doesn't become anything special. All masjids are equal. Nothing is sacred. It is a place to read namaz. And namaz can be read anywhere. It can be read here. It can be read on the road. It can be read on the platform. It can be read in the room at the airport. And therefore, there is no need. You cannot bring murtis into this question. Muhammad will be, therefore, it is sacred. We don't accept that. So that is the principle. People think that temple and mandir are equal. No. The temple and masjid are equal. They are not. Temple is where God lives. And therefore, it is a different thing also. Two temples is a community center. Old age temples is the yoga shalas, then you used to have Sanskrit and Pathshalas, then you used to have marriage arrangement, they used to have astrologers. It used to be a community center. That's why this temple was so important, and that's why the modern Indians focused on that to demolish. So therefore, the Supreme Court said it is right constitutional bench, five judges, that a masjid is not an essential part of Islam. Therefore, if you do anything to a masjid, you are not having the religious feelings of the Islamic people. This is their Supreme Court judgment. Then the Supreme Court also asked Nasim Rao, please tell us, what is the solution of your government for this problem? So Nasim Rao thought his Solicitor General to file an affidavit. And the affidavit says, if it is proven that there was a pre-existing temple, that is, there was a temple before a masjid, then the government will give the entire Ayodhya Ram Janmabhoomi land to the Hindus to build a temple. This is there in the Supreme Court. So Supreme Court then said, okay, there are four petitioners. They are not petitioners, they are suitors. They are filing suits for possession. Two of the Muslim parties, one is Sunni Mahatma, and the other is Jamaat Islami. They say that this area, Ram Janmabhoomi area, is our property. They don't say that our our masjid was here, and it is our religious place, and therefore it should be handed over to us. They say this is a property acquired by Babur, and we as Muslims are the degrees. Therefore, this land belongs to us. Therefore, their claim is on property. The Hindu parties, there are two. One is Ram Janmabhoomi Nyas Samiti, and the other is Akara, Nirbhumi Akara. They both say that there was a temple here, and that temple, we were the trustees. Our temple ancestors were the trustees. So this land should be given to us because we had a temple there. So both the Hindu party and the Muslim party are claiming the land of Ram Janmabhoomi not on religious grounds but on property. And this was going on from 1949, and no decisions of Supreme Court said we will come in lower courts. We will now give it to the Allahabad High Court to decide. So 1994, Allahabad suits, and it took Allahabad High Court 16 years to decide. In 2010, September 30th, they gave a judgment. And what judgment they gave? That Sunni Wakaf Board and Jamaat Islami claim to property is bogus and rejected. One. Two. They said, we recognize that the faith of the Hindus is such and so overwhelming that the central dome of the Babri Mandir that it stood and the right hand side, I mean the left of that, both belong to the Ram temple, and we accept that the central dome is what was the place where Lord Rama was born, and that is Ram Janmabhoomi. This is Allahabad High Court's unanimous opinion. But one judge, he said that, however, to minimize animosity between Hindus and Muslims, the third Gumbaz, the third dome, we will give it to the Muslims for building a masjid. It's too small to have a masjid, but still he said to give it. So the Muslim parties, they said this we will not accept. We want the whole property for us. So they came to Supreme Court in 2010. And finally, SLP, or what you now call it, is still the people. And therefore, because the Muslim parties filed, the two Hindu parties also filed an SLP, saying we want the whole land and we will not agree to one of the domes to be given to the Muslim government. Namaz. From 2010 to this year, 2017, not a single hearing was held by the Supreme Court. Everywhere I went, people were asking me, when is Ram Temple coming? Ashok Singhal, who was the head of the BPHP, he had in 2007 asked me to save the Ram Setu. Ram Setu is the bridge that Rama made. You know that Rama came to Rameshwaram Island. He walked to the end of that island, which is Dhanush Chori, and there he found that the island was completely stuck and there was only the sea. So he sat down for 3 days to pray to Samudra Raja, saying, please show me a way so that I can go to Ganga and rescue Sita. And Samudra Raja ignored him. then in order to this, all these jeevs which are there, all these living beings that are there, they are all dying. So for my foolishness in ignoring your prayer should not affect them. So therefore, he suggested that after the Vishwati, under the water there is a ridge, and the ridge goes all the way to Talayanama in Sri Lanka, and after that you can go to Ashokavatika from there. And so therefore what you do is you put rocks on top of this ridge and you will get a causeway. It's not a bridge, but it's more like a causeway. And you can walk across. Where to find those stones? He said on the shores. There are many rocks because they are not really rocks, they are corals. Corals are fish bones, shellfish shells, all fused into over centuries, they fused into a rock. And one of the things that Hanuman found is that when he went to pick up these rocks and put it, they started floating in the water. It's recorded in the Valmiki. So he said he put those rocks and you will be able to walk across. And that's how Rama walked across and went to Sri Lanka. So this Ram Setu, Mr. Karnataka and Mrs. Madam Sonia Gandhi wanted to destroy it. And Karnataka, he, because he hates Rama, he hates all Hindus and everything, he said that to the Muslim community, they broke Babri Masjid, for you I will break Ram Setu. So he created a new project, Setu Samudram project, stating that the ships have to today go from Kanyakumari to Chennai around Sri Lanka. So instead of that, we will have a canal in between India and Sri Lanka, in the Bangkok Strait and Gulf of Mannar, so that it can travel by the ships. That we are going to give publicly. And so a Setu Samudram project was created to cut through Ram Setu. That is the time both Sudarshan Ji and his associate came to me and said, somehow we must appear in court and stop it. I said, how can I? But Ashok Ji said, I'm sure Ram Chandra Ji will help you. I said, how can we help you? It's a development project. Court will not agree. He said, you try. So I went and somehow the judge took a liking for me and he gave a stay order. Then I argued for 3 years why this cannot be demolished. Karnataka was getting really angry with me. One day he said that who is this Swami to call this Ram Setu? It was called Adam's Bridge. What Ram Setu? Was Ram an engineer? Which engineer he called him? This way we are making fun of Lord Rama. But next day he fell sick. So he had to be admitted to hospital. And the hospital's name was Ramchandra Medical Hospital. So I said, who asked me, Ram Setu, he's from the engineering college? Which engineering college? And then, now you go to Ramchandra Medical Hospital, as Ramchandra Ji got MBBS, are you sure? Now, this is the way they were treated. Even the judge one day told me, I am ready to quash this project if you can give me one answer. The judge's name was Ravindra, Supreme Court judge. He said, tell me, you say that this is a worshipful place, is Ram Setu. How is it possible to go to the middle of the ocean and pray? Can you convince me of that? How do you do it? I said, every morning I pray to Surya Bhagwan, but I don't go to Suraj and come back. Now this man got he had already ministered for the faith. What will happen? So he said, let me try the insurance. So he sent a crane to pick up the pieces of the treasure. And when the crane went near the treasure, that also broke and sunk into the water. No information. All of these said to some sort of project, workers were nervous, oh, there is a ghost here, you know, work. So to pacify them, it was decided that they will hold a havan, a puja, and they will convince the people that whatever the booth is, the ghost is there is not there. So they had to have Aurita. So they got hold of an enemy, a congressman enemy, who was in Ramanathapuram, and asked him to come and do the Aurita. And so that man came, and he didn't pull Aurita, and went back. On the way back to his house, he had a heart attack and died. So, who is doing all this? Obviously, Ramachandraji, when he decides that he will not stand for nonsense, nobody can do any nonsense. Now, the small says, our government has decided no Setu Samagam project which will touch Ram Setu, but they are not making it public. They are not formally informing the Supreme Court on my petition. So about 10 years ago, I went to the Supreme Court and said, please tell this government that they must give this finality because my petition has been pending since 2007. So the Supreme Court issued notice to the government. Thereafter, I wrote a letter to the Prime Minister to call a meeting of senior ministers, and even Dr. has just told me 2 days ago that yes, a affidavit has been prepared to tell the Supreme Say to someone project will not touch. Now I have to ensure that Sethu Sasades Ram Sethu becomes a national heritage monument so that government will be able to mediate it. And then if Ram Temple is made, then it will be possible for you. I hope to set up an aircraft service where after the puja, you will come to land in Ramanathapuram, go to Ram Setu, walk across to Sri Lanka, go and see Ashok Vatika and Ravan's palace and Sanjeevani Mountain also in Sri Lanka. So you become a great tourist situation for us. And for also those of us who are religious, we will get three stars in one row. This is what we are working towards and will be successful. Now before I go further, to tell how Ram Setu Paramahansa will be made, let me first say one more thing. Muhammad Ghori, who brought Islam to India in a systematic way, ascended the throne of Delhi in 1192, and the target was Hindus. All Mughals targeted the Hindus. Many Mughals can now make out, oh, they were all Delhi in 1192, like they have tried to do in this Padmini cinema. And Tipu Sultan. Is there a Tipu Sultan? Tipu Sultan was a studio of the French. And it's not the British. So one day somebody was telling me, why are these Tipu Sultan and not the British? I said, he fought the British because he was a studio of the French. He didn't fight because he wanted to have been in India. In fact, during the entire period, 1192 to 1947. Who are the people who were fighting the foreigners? Only the Hindus. But our history does not teach that. So our people don't know. They keep on saying, we were beaten, we were bred, everybody came from abroad, they beat us, all that. They're the only country which kept fighting with every part. And in 1947, it was the victory of the Hindus. But unfortunately, Jawaharlal Nehru became prime minister. But now, for the first time, we forgive the Hindus for the natural forces combined. Our BJP vote decreased from 21% to 31%. And we lost. Actually, we got it. And tomorrow, it goes from 31% to 38%. We get 2/3 majority in Parliament. And this is, we have seen in UP, during the assembly elections, we did not give one ticket to a Muslim. Not because we are against Muslims, but with no candidate came forward who met our qualifications. So we did not give a single, 404 seats, not a single Muslim. But people said now you are losing 125 assembly seats out of 404 because we did not give a Muslim ticket. But when the results came out, we got 75% of the seats and all this 125, 185 seats. Why? Because all the Muslim women voted for us. And the only party who could do it to the law. So vote for BJP. Now, she has also come over to us, Bohras, Khojas, Sufis. They all joined with us. And we will build a country where Hindus and other religions can live and work together. That is what our focus is. But history, the atrocities of history, we are not going to forget. When I had a talk with Asaf Owaisi one day, he said, are you going to take revenge? I said, no. But you demolished 40,000 temples. The Islamic rulers demolished 40,000 temples. And I am giving you a Krishna package. I said, what is Krishna package? I said, you give up Krishna Mandir in Mathura, Ayodhya Rama Mandir, and Kashi free, and the rest you can have. He said, how is this Krishna package? I said, just before the beginning of the Mahabharata war, Krishna went to Duryodhana and said, you have Hastinapur, you have Indraprastha, you be Raja, but give 5 villages to the Pandavas. But that foolish Duryodhana said, no, why you not giving him the space on the top of a little bit of needle? And what happened here? Hastinapur gone, Indraprastha gone, and his life also gone. So if you don't give 3, then you will take all 40,000. I am telling them that what you have to do is to accept to build a masjid somewhere else. And we will build a temple around the Bhumi. And we live happily together. So Muslim leaders are telling me that is not possible. Why? I said, you don't think it's a fair settlement? He said, it's a good settlement. But we cannot publicly accept it. So why? He said, you get the order of the Supreme Court. I said, if you are ready for an order like this, why not accept it? We both go together and tell the Supreme Court. And he said, no, there is a difficulty. I said, what difficulty? He said, unlike you people, we Muslim community have lots of experience. And the moment we accept an agreement and go to court, they will say, you have taken money from the Hindus and sold out and sent terrorists after us to kill us. You have no such problem, we have such problem. So therefore, get an order from the Supreme Court. That's why negotiated settlement, anybody can try. And Shishi Ramachandra has tried in a very able, good man. But I know, I told him also, I went to his ashram and told him, the Muslims cannot agree because only a court order will be something we can tell the community. We are in the court order. following reasons. Number one, Narasimha Rao has said that the government will hand over the land if it is true that there is a temple over the temple below. Gauri Nanjish committee also says the same. Supreme Court asked the Allahabad High Court to find out whether there was a temple below. So the archaeological survey of India was asked, and the archaeological survey of India said that there are two men in the team of two of the most famous experts. One, Dr. D.B. Lal, and the other, K. Mohammed from Kerala. Both of them sat together, used satellite imaging, laser rays, all modern technology. Then they dug under. And the report was given in 2005 to the Allahabad High Court to state that below where the modern university stood, there is even today a foundation of a very large Vaishnava Mandir there. So now, Narasimha Rao's assurance to be used. Any time our government can go into the Supreme Court, that this is the assurance given by the previous government on a cabinet resolution, it is binding on us, and so we say now that we need to act as leaders. But since the Muslim Party is not a core party, therefore we are ready. But the question is how to get the hearing done. So that's how I came into the picture. I find a big petition saying that these people are fighting for property. I am not interested in property. I have under Article 25 of the Constitution a fundamental right to worship Lord Rama. Will you please read Article 25? Fundamental right to worship is guaranteed to all citizens. But I am not being allowed to worship because we put so many issues. Then I am not able to worship. There is a small temple there, Ramwala temple, but there is so much restriction that I am not able to worship there. So either remove the restrictions or you solve, hear this matter and settle it. So it is on that basis that I give all these arguments that in Saudi Arabia, the demolition of Masjid is according to the Supreme Court only is not an essential part of Islamic religion, namaz anywhere, all these arguments are given. And the Supreme Court was impressed and said, why don't you argue the main matter? I said, how can I argue the main matter? Because they are all fighting for property, minus the fundamental rights. They said, no, give me any your party. So the Supreme Court has given me a party, and I have gone on the first day to the Supreme Court and said, on the very August 21st, that their hearing was, that please hear me first, because after that you don't have to hear anything. Why? Because I am saying I have a fundamental right to worship, where faith tells you Ram was born. Nobody can challenge my faith. And the faith of all Hindus is Ram is born. And I want to worship it. And therefore my fundamental right has been protected by the court. These people, these four parties, they are only asking for property. Fundamental right of mine to pray and ordinary right to property. So the Supreme Court in a number of judgments says, where on an issue there is a clash between fundamental right and ordinary right, the court shall accept the fundamental right as a solution. So after I said that, all the Muslim parties got me agitated. So I did the Supreme Court Chief Justice. Thought, let us take this in a different way. So they told me, do you mind me speaking last? I said, I don't mind speaking. So let you hear them, but it will be a waste of time. Because my argument, there is no answer. It is the master. I am expecting the, since everything is on documents, therefore, if you winter, and then we start again on 1st of January. So 1st January, 2nd, and then February, then March. In 3 months, all the arguments can be completed. And so by end of April, the court can reserve its judgment. Then the other right to leave the judgment. So they need a vacation. So May vacation, June vacation. So July, I am expecting the judgment will come, and on Diwali, in the Dharmaprabha, in Ram Janmabhoomi, you can celebrate Diwali.
And when the constitution was framed, it was framed by three people.
Rajan Prasad, President of the Constituent Assembly, Sardar Patel, Chairman of the Fundamental Rights Committee, and Dr. Ambedkar, Chairman of the Drafting Committee. These three people nominated. Jawaharlal Nehru was not in the Constituent Assembly very much. These people made a constitution. Today, people say, how this house started in the how can you repeat on my right to eat? I said, easy, Article 48. It says the government shall ban these sort of cows. And then Article 48. Article 44 is about the Uniform Civil Code. Article 351 is about including only the vocabulary of Sanskrit and Hindi and removing all these Urdu words so that Sanskrit receive words of their three languages. Karnataka has 60% Sanskrit words. Malayalam has 80%, Bengali has 85%, Gujarat has 70%. So many Sanskrit words. Even Tamil has 42%. I calculated it by going through the dictionary. Just the Tamil Nadu has a big fight with me. He said, no, no, the Tamil is pure. We don't have any Sanskrit word. I said, well, what was your name? Tamil Nadu. So this all this nonsense has been fit into our brains. Sanskrit is the language which ultimately should come. And the way to bring it is through Sanskritizing Hindi over a period of time. As we go along, soon one day Hindi will become Sanskrit. But I am saying this, that we are for removing and liberating Ram Temple and of course following Krishna Temple and Rajshri Krishna. But that is to liberate your mind. These are not things that we fought for 800 or 1000 years. And we want to reach it. In no other country, the victor has become the inferior party. We now country we are treated like that. We have to see that our culture grows and flowers. And that is the only way. And people like Ambedkar have written books on the glory of our culture. They were not honored by our people. Sardar Patel merged our country, so many small kingdoms into our country. Did he get the Bharat Ratna? He did not get the Bharat Ratna during the Congress period. I found when I became the Minister of Law in 1991, that time Chandrasekhar asked me, who shall we give the Bharat Ratna? And I said, let me see the old list. So I went through the files. And I found that it was the first Bharat Ratna was given in 1954. And the file is written like this. I, Jawaharlal Nehru, hereby award Bharat Ratna to Jawaharlal Nehru, son Jawaharlal Nehru, Prime Minister of India. And did not give to Sardar Patel till 1991. Ambedkar did not get to the Bharat Ratna till 1980, that is to 1990. So all these great men were denied the honor. Because we are ashamed to admit that we are a Hindu country. Hindu country doesn't mean that only Hindus can be Prime Minister or President. That will be by the richest process. Hindu country does not mean that Muslims cannot read Namaz. Of course they can read Namaz. We are not Saudi Arabia. In Saudi Arabia, you cannot build a temple. In Saudi Arabia, you cannot celebrate Diwali. In Saudi Arabia, you cannot even hold Satyanarayan Puja in Saudi Arabia. In Saudi Arabia, you cannot carry Ramchandra's photo in your pocket. We are not Saudi Arabia. We are not Muslims. We are Hindus. And as Hindus, we accept that all paths lead to God. But at the same time, the culture of this country cannot be an imported culture. It cannot be a foreign culture. It has to be our indigenous culture, and that's how we are doing. And for that purpose, you should never be on the defensive. Look at how they're putting you on the defenses today. They say, inclusiveness. What do you mean by inclusiveness? We include everybody. Yes, everybody Then you can be an American in India, you can be an Englishman in India, yes, but only thing you can't be a Hindu in India or something like that. We cannot accept that. Inclusiveness means we accept, and Hindus do accept, all religions equal God. And that is the most inclusive philosophy. We say, Aham Bija Palaveti, Manana Ramu Chetasam, Udala Chetanam, Vasudeva Pudukam. We are the people who say the whole world will be God. And they put us to put them in inclusiveness. Then everything is tolerance. Tolerance for what? I might be allowed to be called. If you don't allow me, it's intolerant. What do you mean? It's a constitution. Constitution says you don't need power. So sorry, you can't. What amend the constitution if you can? But we will not allow it as long as the constitution says. They say that if you say Azadi, you put us in jail, that's intolerant. What do you mean? In the constitution, the fundamental right to speak is subject to restrictions. These restrictions are for national security, integrity of India. They're in Article 19, Bracket 2. So how can you say that if I stop somebody from saying Azadi, Kashmir ki Azadi, no, we can't accept that. You want to go to Pakistan and say it, but in India, you cannot say it under the Constitution of India. Therefore, don't be defensive on that. Similarly, they say that I have a fundamental right to practice my religion. You cannot interfere. And this is this little talaq. That means you are saying you can't interfere my religion. Again, you are not in the constitution. Article 25 says you have a fundamental right to practice your religion. But it will be subject to three restrictions. Restriction number one, morality. Restriction number two, public health. If it's bad for your health, then you won't allow it. You say, I can cut my head off to please God, one body. No, we will not allow that. Or untouchability, we will not allow that. Just because you say it is part of your religion. And the third thing is public order. So when this question of triple talaq came, he said, of course the government can amend it. And they are giving a law to prohibit it. Why? Because it is immoral. And why is it important? Because men and women are equal. We cannot have two different standards. That a man can give it by SMS or by WhatsApp. He can send it to talaq, 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 but a woman cannot do it. So we have to have equality. And therefore, we will start this triple talaq. And once we decide, there are no problems at all. Of course, the women are very really happy. Because we have now promised that the meaning of inheritance laws, we are going to make changes so that they have become equal. So it is this reason why I have created Virat in this Mansabha. You see, and it is now spread all over the country. We just had one big convention in Rishikesh. The mindset is important. Your mind must be free. Your mind must know the true history of your country. That freedom is what we want to educate our people. Otherwise, what is the use of being a very nice man if your mind is not free? What is the use of being strong if your mind is demented? For instance, in a circus, there will be five strong lions. Lion, if you say, seal. There are five strong lions, welfare. One thing, ringmaster will come in, close the cage, and then he will order the lion. Get up, go up to the bench. They will all go up to the bench. Then he will say, open your mouth. They will all open their mouth. Then he will put his head in each one of their mouths, and all the spectators will cheer. Why don't these lions bite him his head off? Kill him off, finish him off. Because of small talks that we brought to obey, and that obedience is what is responsible for their behavior, not only their own strength. This is why the explanation has to be given. When people used to ask me, why Manmohan Singh is afraid of Sonia Gandhi? He's sitting on the Prime Minister's chair. He can do anything, but he's scared of this Italian lady. Because he's on That we learn is freedom to say